Multiplicity is 2. Can you guess what is geometric multiplicity? Yeah, so not again, but again, right? So if you take the space span of all x such that a minus lambda I x equal to 0, and geometric multiplicity is the dimension of the subspace. And algebraic multiplicity should not be always equal, is not always equal to algebraic. The matrix is diagonalizable if these two coincide. So an important class, probably the most important class of diagonalizable matrices, is the class of so-called normal matrices. So a normal matrix, and that's one of the standard questions for the test, for the exam. So what is a normal matrix? A normal matrix is called normal if it commutes with its Hermitian conjugate. So this is an important. That will be probably the final proof of today's lecture, is that the class of normal matrices coincides A is normal if A equal U lambda U star, where U is unitary, lambda is diagonal. So you can always check, given the matrix, you can always check without doing any eigendecompositions that a matrix has orthonormal set of eigenvectors. So you see, because this is an eigendecomposition, because what means unitary that U star equals U inverse. And the columns of U, each column of U is an eigenvector of the matrix A, and these eigenvectors are, well, then they have length 1 because of the construction, but they also have an orthonormal set of eigenvectors, so this is the ideal case. So, for example, if you have Hermitian matrices, Hermitian matrices is obviously, it is obviously a normal matrix because A star equals A. And this shows that they can be diagonalized by a unitary matrix. So, everything is good with the eigenvectors of this matrix for the Hermitian case. But the general case is the matrices that commute with Hermitian. Can you give any other example of a normal matrix besides Hermitian matrix?
Any unitary.
Unitary, right? Unitary, yes. But actually, the eigenvalues of a unitary matrix is a separate story. So, eigendecomposition of a unitary matrix is a non-trivial thing. It's not a simple thing. So, one example of non-diagonalizable matrix is the example of this Jordan block, where you have this triangle matrix with the same values on the diagonal, so two eigenvalues. So for triangle, if you have triangle matrices, actually eigenvalues are very easy to compute, right? If you have a triangle matrix, then all the eigenvalues will get back to it later on. For the triangle matrix, eigenvalues are located on the diagonal. This is, it has to be proven, but it's a very simple fact. So we have eigenvalue 1 of multiplicity 2, but only one eigenvector, which is the first column of the identity matrix. And this matrix is not diagonalizable, and that's why in the Jordan form, the matrix is reduced not to the diagonal form, carbon form, where this is block diagonal matrix. Each block corresponds to one eigenvalue. So it has the same number, and that there is also something here. So that's a brief view of the Jordan form. But why Jordan form is never used in practice? Because it requires that the matrix has the same eigenvalues that have algebraic multiplicity larger than 1. So it has the same eigenvalues. But even if you take a small perturbation of such a matrix, so for example, we take this matrix, right, which is a Jordan block, and we make an arbitrary small perturbation, for example, due to machine precision. Now it has two different eigenvalues, and hence it's diagonalizable. The problem, of course, if you try to do this, to compute eigenvectors of such a matrix, the matrix, the columns of S, which correspond to eigenvectors, they will be very close to collinear, and the S inverse will have much energy. So S will be very ill-conditioned. But again, in practice, you'll never have exactly the same eigenvalues, and if you can formally run the code, you get some numbers, but the error will be quite large. So Jordan 4 is very unstable for numerical computation. So there are small exceptions when you try to regularize it and somehow relax, but in practice, no one uses it except for some analytical or theoretical considerations.
Okay, is it clear?
Something else has to be done. Yeah, so before going into how we compute the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, I'd like to discuss the applications. Yeah, so probably the most well-known eigenvalue problem is the Schrödinger equation. So the Schrödinger equation is a very large eigenvalue problem. The difficulty is that this matrix is huge. So if you try to discretize, so the wave function, it depends on the, many of you have seen this, so if you have a system with electrons and nuclei, then some approximation, you need to describe it by function of n e variables, the wave function. And even if you have a small molecule, the number of electrons is quite large. So you will have, for water, you will have 18 electrons. So you have a function that depends on 18 variables. And there are other things, like you need to put some constraints and so on. And if you do a simple discretization of this function, then you will get a huge number of parameters. Of course, such kind of simple discretization is never used, but and much more complicated things are done. But, well, again, this is sort of, and the operator is very simple. The operator is sort of Laplace operation plus multiplication of diagonal matrices. And yeah, so many of the supercomputer power, I think more than 50%, is in some sense solving this equation for different type of data. Drug design, computational material, and so on. Probably what you have heard more, the eigenvalues are very important in mechanics. So if you have any construction, mechanical construction, a bridge or whatever, then these frequencies, then the eigenvalues, they correspond to characteristic frequencies. So what we have, if you have a matrix that describes our system, and we have an eigenvector, then if you put a forcing here that is aligned with the eigenvector, you may encounter catastrophic growth of the response. So if, for example, if the eigenvalues are negative, it means the stability of the dynamical system. Right? So if you have some, if there is even a small positive eigenvalue, which you will not see for the current input to the system, but if you design a specific frequency, you will get the complete disaster. So that's why the study, the vibrational frequencies are crucial. There is a huge need to study this vibration. And this is related to the effect of resonance. And again, for any mechanical construction, you have to study it. Otherwise, you cannot build a bridge without computing the vibrational frequency of the structure. And also another application is the model order reduction of complex. You have a complex system, it may be a mechanical system, it may be an acoustic system, it may be an electrical circuit. For all of this, you need to study this characteristic frequency. So for example, for acoustics, there is quite a few research done in this field, and for example, you need to design an opera hall in such a way that the acoustic response is close to what you want. So for example, I think it was in Vienna, they had to redesign the opera hall because it was designed for the case where people in opera were wearing a very complex costumes, so it was included in the acoustic response. Now everyone goes to opera in jeans, so the sound is different, so they basically had to put certain plates at locations in such a way that you have amplification of certain directions. And then again, you have to study frequencies. And if you, for example, design an acoustic chamber with specific eigenmodes and eigenfrequencies, you can really see very good effects. So we have a dynamic standing here, but the eigenmode would be directional. So the sound goes like this, you stand here, you hear nothing, you stand here, and it's very loud. So, and this acoustic room looks very weird, it's a sort of polyhedron with all the angles that are not rectangular and so on. It's very difficult to build such kind of things, but okay, all, for example, hi-fi stuff and noise cancellation is more or less related to computation of eigenmodes because you have to suppress frequencies. And eigenvalue, another interpretation of the eigenvalue is frequency. Large eigenvalue, large frequency, that's typical for differential, small eigenvalue, small frequency, and so on. So that's the case. You probably have seen this video. Hope it will work. That's the classical example of the resonance effect. This is a bridge in Volgograd. I don't know if you see it, but it's doing oscillations from the wind. And still standing there, still working after that. But you can have very large mechanical construction with the road just doing like this. That's what happens if you don't compute eigenvalues in the right way. Yeah, this is not a fake video, it's a real video of a bridge doing some oscillations. Okay? The people working there, so they're very brave. Okay. Let's go further. So another classical example of the eigen vector computations, the page rank. Now it's more, of course, sort of a history, but it still plays a role in other applications. So it's not used in Google so much, but so the idea is that you have a collection of web pages and you need to define the importance of each page. And therefore, we only look at links from ith page to jth page
And
you have this recursive definition that the importance of the page is the important